So my name is Narayana Subramaniam. I am a head and neck oncologist, a surgeon basically by trade. I'm also a researcher and a technology enthusiast. So my talk today is called You Don't Need a White Coat to Save Lives. So if you look at our traditional idea of a hospital, you have a healthcare worker, a doctor or a nurse, you have a patient, you have a lot of equipment that's sophisticated and expensive, and you have sterile halls. But what if I were to tell you that healthcare is changing so rapidly, and that change is driven by people who aren't wearing white coats or stethoscopes? It's driven by people who are writing lines of code. It's driven by engineers who are building wonderful pieces of equipment, and people who are reimagining this idea of healthcare. And the idea that I want to share with you is that medicine belongs to us all. So a rather stark example back home. So I operate on a lot of oral cancer or mouth cancer. And India unfortunately has the dubious distinction of being the cancer capital of the world. So if you look at India over here, it's bright red because India has one of the highest incidences of mouth cancer in the world. So every year we have nearly 80,000 new patients of oral cancer, and 50,000 of them die. So why does that happen? The reason is very simple. Unfortunately, many of them present to us at an advanced stage. By the time it's already large, it's involved a large part of the mouth or the neck, and they need huge surgeries and radiation, and their survival is very modest. But the irony here is that oral cancer is actually visible, unlike other cancers in the human body. So you can see a small red patch, you can see lumps and bumps in your mouth every day when you're brushing your teeth. So what's the problem? Why is this so difficult for us to pick up? And why aren't we able to treat it more effectively? So that's a question that we are forced to ask ourselves as people who treat this disease. So why is oral cancer so deadly? The reason is because of delayed detection. So you have a symptom over here, you have a patch, you have a red lump or a bump, you have some pain, you have an ulcer. And typically by the time you get to a doctor, by the time you get a biopsy, by the time we make a diagnosis, it's delayed. And in India, the miserable situation is sometimes that delay is 9 months. 9 precious months are lost, and then you end up with an advanced disease. And oral cancer, even though we can see it very early, it's rare for us to catch it early. It's even worse for people who live from rural backgrounds and people who are disadvantaged, because just to make it to a doctor or a place where it can be diagnosed takes that much longer. So access is a huge, huge problem. So we reimagined it a little bit. So my colleague Hardik Pandya, not the cricketer but the engineer, started working on this about 7 years ago, where we thought about this differently. Why do we need to drag patients into the healthcare sector? Why do we have to bring them back to a hospital for a test? Why don't we try and take cancer detection to them? So we built a funny little device, which is a 3D printed module that sits on top of the top of any microscope. So it basically is a universal adapter for any microscope. And it does something very simple. It just images cells. Right? So it images cells, and you can make a simple swab. You can take a brush from an oral cancer, make a simple swab, and you image it. And it can use the existing internet. You don't need Wi-Fi. You can use mobile telephony to send the abnormal looking cells over to a pathologist who will tell us if it looks like cancer or not. So essentially what we did is we created a handheld lab for cancer detection that would basically be a fraction of the cost and take much, much less time. So what it taught us when we were studying this workflow is that a lot of these problems are actually very simple to address. So you take a simple brush, you make a swab, and you image it just like you would scan a document. You send those cells off and you have a pathologist who tells you, is it cancer, is it not cancer? So you don't have to drag the patient back into a city. You don't have to drag them into a lab. And we have a certain amount of accuracy. And the idea here is that whole process gets shrunk from days into minutes. And we realize something, that the innovation here happens not necessarily in labs in hospitals where you have people with PhDs and a lot of medical training, but we are able to save lives in villages. So the next place that I'll take you to is the operation theater. So I deal with head and neck cancer, which is quite gruesome. You've all seen the tobacco warnings, unfortunately, in the movie theater. But the reason why head and neck cancer is such a scourge for us is because when we treat these cancers, it not only changes how our patients see the world, it changes how the world sees them. It affects their speech, their appearance, their ability to swallow, and their social functioning. But we now use what's called virtual surgical planning. So we have a simple CT scan that's been around for decades and decades. Many of us have seen it. But now we are able to turn that into patient-specific models. So we turn it into a three-dimensional image, and that gives us a print that basically mimics our patient's entire anatomy. So imagine the confidence that we have when we are trying to rebuild a patient's jawbone, when we are able to have an exact print of their skull. Previously, when we did these surgeries, it relied heavily on experience and instinct of the surgeon, but now we are able to practice and do these surgeries, mock them up, do them multiple different ways using a computer simulation so that we get it right and it's a lot more accurate. So we have gone to a point where we go from a virtual jaw to a real smile. So where this was really very important for us was when we started around 3.5 years ago, a project called Jaw in a Day. So typically what happened for patients with oral cancer is they would lose a large part of their jaw, then they would get some form of reconstruction with tissue from elsewhere in the body. They would get some kind of implants, but they wouldn't have teeth for often a year and a half or more. Many of them never got dental rehabilitation, which means they never had teeth, and that was that. So these were people who unfortunately would not rejoin the workforce, and they would never engage socially after that. They would be recluses. They would basically be prisons of their own home. So we started seeing, could we shrink this entire expensive, lengthy process into a single surgery? It hadn't been done in India before. So a lot of us got together, worked on it very hard, and we were able to achieve that. So we went from a point where patients who underwent this surgery would probably never eat a meal in public to a point where you can't actually tell which entire jaw has been replaced. So the point here is that when we look at this success, it is as much the success of the surgeon as it is as the engineer who planned the entire surgery with us and the material scientist who designed the implants. So the point that I want to make here for all of you, even if you're not interested in studying for many, many years to do medicine and have as much white hair as I do, by the time you reach my age, you can have a huge impact in medicine and healthcare, and that's something you should all definitely consider. The next thing that I want to talk about is AI and empathy. A lot of our speakers have spoke about AI and empathy, but one thing that we need to realize is that artificial intelligence is a game changer in health as well, and when we use it the right way, it can be used very, very positively. So when we have a patient who's diagnosed with cancer and who's going through that journey, there's a lot of uncertainty. There are a lot of questions. And unfortunately, most of those questions pop up as soon as they leave the consultation room. So patients want support. They want verified information. We are now using ChatGPT-like simulations. We're using large language models with guardrails, of course, to answer questions for these patients. So to give them verifiable information, to give them comfort, to give them confidence. And in India, it's so important for patients to have all of this information in their own language. So for patients to be able to understand, remove all of the medical jargon, and get the information that they need to get through their treatment, AI has been absolutely transformational. So again, I want to impress on all of you that you absolutely don't need a white coat to save lives. So when you look at the future of medicine, it is and should be diverse. You could be somebody who writes code that turns into algorithms for life-saving softwares, for sepsis detection, for virtual surgical planning, for robotic surgery. You could be an engineer who designs hardware. You could be designing a low-cost MRI that costs a fraction of the cost that could be packed into the back of a truck. You could be a design engineer who puts all of these things together so that patients can navigate hospitals in a more efficient way and get treatment faster. Of course, if you have nothing else interesting to do, you can always take a long time and become a surgeon.
Yes.
So what I want to impress on you is very, very simple. The future of medicine absolutely belongs to all of us. The ability to save lives is too important for us to restrict it to the few members of us who wear white coats. And the future really belongs to any of you who have the interest and the passion to build something and act. Thank you very much.